It's 7 p.m. and it's Tuesday night. I got my laptop on and I feel alright. I got a few joints rolled and my munch is made. Got my headphones on and I close the door, don't disturb me. It's time to stand up tall and say some things about the shitty world we're living in with the boys at Raconteurs News. To Raconteurs,
Raconteurs,
to Raconteurs,
Raconteurs,
to Raconteurs News, Raconteurs News, Raconteurs News. Raconteurs News, Raconteurs News. Oh, yeah.
Well, a very good evening and welcome to Tuesday's edition of Raconteurs News. It's the 21st of August 2018 and it's the usual RN Tuesday night setup. And Andy's with me. Andy, how are you doing, mate?
Good evening, mate. I'm brilliant, thanks. Having a little problem with the old Facebook starting off again, so I'm just having to restart that one. So we're not on Facebook Live at the minute, but welcome to everybody on YouTube Live. So.
Brilliant. Well, it's been a lovely day today. It's been a nice. We've got nice clear skies. There don't seem to be any trails going across the sky, so tonight might be a night to go out and do some UFO watching, which is quite topical for tonight. But wait, listen, what about these things that are going on all around? I mean, I live in a world. I can't believe that I live in a world where Norman Bettison, the bloke who was the accused of lying over Hillsborough, has had all the charges dropped against him by the CPS because there apparently wasn't enough evidence, or some people were dead or whatever. That's a huge, huge thing. And I think we'll probably try and get Tony Farrell on at some point and talk about that. And also, we live in a world where I saw this today and I really couldn't believe it, but it said, Healthline, it's Healthline says that using the medical term vagina is not gender inclusive language and uses front hole instead. So I don't know what they use for the back hole, whether it's tradesman's entrance or whatever, but you know, we've got some weird stuff going on. And also, as well, another thing I noticed on social media was a company called Eyes See You Baby Safety Solutions, and they had these door things that you put on your car door handle, the sensory reminders that you've got a kid in the car, your baby's in the car. So when your baby's in the car, you pop this thing on the handle so that you don't forget and accidentally lock them in and leave them. I mean, this is just what sort of world we're living in at the moment. It's out of this world, really, isn't it? It's really, really out of this world. Like our guest tonight, why don't you give us an introduction of our guest for this evening?
Yeah, no worries, mate. I thought about you when I saw that about the Bettison having the charges dropped against him. And as for the rest of the stuff, it's just more evidence of this insane asylum that we're stuck in at the minute. But tonight, it's a regular guest, and I'm very pleased to welcome back Gary Heseltine from UFO Truth Magazine. I think we've probably done the intro with Gary more times than any other guest. So let's just welcome Gary. And if he wants to just give us a brief little intro on himself, that's fine. But if he wants to skip that and get straight to the meat and potatoes, that's entirely up to you. Welcome back, Gary.
It's nice always to be on your show. Thank you for having me back. Quick resume. I was a police officer for almost 24 years, a detective constable for 19 years, advanced interview of suspects and witnesses, had a sighting of a UFO when I was 16, launched a unofficial national police database when I was 42 in 2002 for British police officers to report UFO sightings or that were involved in events. Now got well over 500 cases, well over 1,100 police officers, which is a lot. The media used to take a lot of interest in me when I created that database. Now they don't pay any attention whatsoever, despite the numbers involved, which is, I think, you know, indicative of the way that they play this subject down when serious facts emerge. And basically, when you were talking about Betterson, the irony is that the CPS are the ones who made the decision to charge him. Now, you only charge somebody if the CPS think there's enough evidence. So what changed between them charging him then and where they obviously thought there was enough evidence to go to a court, what's changed to the evidence now? That's what I'd be saying to the families, because I would think that many of them are very, very upset and with just cause.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I think the reasons given was that there were three witnesses apparently that were due to give evidence. Two of them had contradictory statements apparently from the inquest, and also one other one had died. So he obviously weren't going to be giving evidence, and his evidence probably testimony probably died with him. And whether or not there's anything nefarious in that, I don't know.
Well, obviously, I'm not privy to all those details, but if that were the case, then there may be genuine reasons why that they thought that they couldn't mount a successful prosecution. But I would imagine a lot of the families are very upset.
I would imagine that beyond upset, I would imagine a lot of them are absolutely furious, because they kept a lid on it for so long, and then to suddenly be given that dangling carrot that the truth is going to finally come out. I might say a bit like Tom DeLonge and his buddies over there. And to have it snatched back off them, it must be devastating for them.
It must be, and I think there's been a lot of intrigue, and from my own point of view, when we talk, I joined the police in 1989, and it was kind of like a different regime from the old days. It was a new style of training, and I was on the very first training course of that. So it was like a new broom, but I was 29 when I joined. But there was still the mentality of we write statements together on major incidents where there were fights and things like that. And to a degree, that was fine, but I always remember... and I was a probationer in uniform, and there was a big fight and lots of people were arrested. I didn't arrest somebody, but we were all writing up our pocketbooks, and the inspector was there. And there's nothing wrong with that, as long as you put in only what you saw. Well, he started kind of like telling us what to put. And I said, well, I can only put what I saw, sir. And he looked at me and he said, no, you've got to understand, we do this together. And I said, yeah, but I can only put what I saw. That's my evidence into this chain. And he said, I can see I might have a problem with you. And the inference was that we all say things together. And I do believe that some of the statements were ordered to be taken again. But that wouldn't have come from the officers themselves. That would have come from on high. And you should never re-tamper your statement once it's submitted. But there does seem to be some evidence that happened. But that, as I say, that wouldn't be from the officer on the ground, the PC or whatever. That'll have been come from on high, and I suspect that was to cover their bases, and that would be wrong to me. But anyway, that's nothing to do with UFOs, but there you go.
Well, yeah, it's always good to have a little chat about what's going on before we get into the real meat and potatoes. But so...
Sorry, before we do, I'd like to point anybody that's listening that's not heard the interview. I did an interview with Tony Farrell a couple of years ago on Hillsborough, quite an in-depth two-hour interview with him. And so I'd, if anybody's not heard that, then I suggest you go back, because he's got some great facts about what happened, and also he's got a decent enough theory as far as I'm concerned. It does seem to hold water. But yeah, that's back in the archives, or you can find it on YouTube. Right, sorry, Andy.
Yeah, no worries. So over to Gary. I mean, where do you want to start? You've got so much on your plate at the minute.
I can honestly say that I retired in 2013, and obviously to create and launch the UFO Truth magazine, and it's steadily gone on. But this year, with getting involved in the co-writing of Capel Green documentary, which has grown far bigger than what anybody originally envisaged, it's probably been the busiest year since I retired, which is good, but sometimes you want to rest. And with doing the magazine, doing that, doing other stuff, and I'm also doing a non-UFO writing project, it's like juggling a lot of balls, as it were, and it's hard work, and plus you've got to have a home life, etc., etc. So it's difficult, but it's a nice kind of pressure, but at times you do get tired. But you know, I think my excitement will really begin to grow when we have finished all the US filming and the UK filming, and then we can get down to the editing, which is not my forte, which is the director's forte. So I'm looking forward to them, in a sense, the process of seeing it all come together, because it's a massive undertaking there.
Awesome. Regarding, I realise you constrained what you can say. You can't give, you can't really give any secrets away. But
well, I can, but I'd get shot. So I'm not going to. I can obviously give you some hints at, and in broad terms, can say things like, and I've said it regularly on radio shows, is that when I originally had my 7-year association with Colonel Holt, a man I still respect, but I ended that association for a particular reason. And what I was going to say is that when I met with Holt in December 2007, and then we began this collaboration period working on a fictional cinema script, film script, that I wrote and he would just endorse, read, and give pointers to on various pertinent facts. But I had no reason when I met Holt to think or doubt anything that he said. And the sad thing is that over time, I began to realize that he knew a lot more than he was telling me. And that's something that he said he would tell me, you know, he'd be honest with me from the off. But over time, he wasn't forthcoming. And so that, in a sense, began to dawn on me that he knew a lot more than he was saying. So now, once that split occurs, I had no desire, no thoughts of linking with Larry Warren over anything. But it was just came up out of the blue with a phone call from the director, who basically said, you know, I've met Larry, and he's given me your number. I'm thinking of doing a documentary. Would you like to get involved? And obviously I said, well, what's the nature of what you're trying to tell? And we had a brief discussion, and I assumed, wrongly as it turns out, that he was seeking finance from a TV company or station, whatever, to get money to get the project. So I just said, well, are you aware of a lot of recent controversy with Larry? Not that I've ever doubted him, but there is a lot of controversy about him. And he said, yeah. And I said, well, if it was me to get your money, and again, I'm thinking it's to get finance, I said I would seek to get somebody to do a polygraph, because Larry's always said he's happy to take it. And that would seem to me a good way to get your money if he passes it. And so anyway, he went off with that. And a couple of weeks later, he rang me up and said, yeah, I've got a polygraph all arranged. And I'm not giving anything away now, because in the trailer, she's introduced on camera, the 5-minute trailer that we released in December 2017. It's a lady called Patty Musicaro, who runs her own company in London, but she's an American, and she's married to an English guy, so she's an Anglophile, and she turns out to be arguably Britain's top polygraph examiner. She's done over 2,000 polygraph examinations. She's worked for the American police, the British police. She's worked in private practice. I think she has links to intelligence agencies in various places. So she's well regarded, and I think she might even be the secretary or the chairwoman of the Great Britain Association of Polygraph Examiners, if there is such a thing. I know there is, but that might not be the actual wording. So she seems to be a very eminent person in her field, and subsequently Larry was arranged. He went down and he passed the test. Now, I'm not going to go into any more depth than that. We know he passed the test because we're making a documentary. If he'd failed the test, I guess we wouldn't have been making a documentary. But that's how it all came about. I think what started as a relatively small idea to tell, in a sense, what is called the Capel Green story, which is, in effect, Larry's story, which is controversial. And I've always understood that it's controversial because it didn't seem to match that of the other principal witnesses. But what I can say to you is that I'd always I'd met Larry Warren many times. I think the first time about 2005 at a conference in Manchester, and then I probably met him once before we ended up on the same plane going out to Laughlin for the 2010 US conference, the last of the Bob and Terry Brown week-long conferences in Laughlin, Nevada, on the Colorado River, and he was on the same flight, so we ended up chatting on that, and we were there for a week, so I obviously saw him a lot. I'd always, as an advanced interviewer, always been pretty good at sussing people out anyway, but with the extra training that I'd had, I kind of know what to look for more, and I'm very good at reading body language. And everything in his body language said he was there, and he always gave if anything, he gave too much detail, it's hard to lie. If you've not got an involvement, it's very hard to lie consistently. Yes, you can tell small lies, you can tell big lies, not very often, but to tell big lies often with exactly the same recall, exactly a great deal of bang, bang, bang information is extremely hard to do. So I was always convinced that his account was genuine. And that was always my thought. So I was obviously a little bit nervous. I think it's a bit like going for your driving test. You know that you've done all right, you should pass your driving test, but you know that it's one of those pass or fail things, you might fail. So I was a little bit nervous going into the polygraph. Not that I disbelieved him, but just because it's a test. And in life, people generally do not like undergoing any kind of test. But he was very pretty relaxed about it, which amazed me. And he passed. So that's all I'm going to say on that. And more will obviously feature in the documentary, as the 5-minute trailer alluded to. But that's what kicked off the project, it has just grown. I'm not going into too much detail, but what I'm going to say is that when I'd originally met Holt, I said, right, I'm going to read everything and then come back to you in about 4 months' time. So that was like April 2008. And then I started to ask him question, and he came back. And we had a very amicable, largely email. I only met him twice, but it was largely emails on a regular basis. And he would seem to be fine. But on this occasion, now in a different kind of researcher mode, and especially in a sense as the lead researcher for this documentary and co-writer, then it has to be spot on from my point of view. Yeah, you know, I am putting my reputation on the line, and I'm happy to do that because I believe in what we're doing. But what it meant was that I felt that for this documentary, I kind of had to take Larry out of the equation to prove the Capel Green scenario, which is essentially UFOs, a UFO in a landed field, a meeting with entities, for want of a better word, and the base commander in a kind of like a face-off. Now that's an extraordinary claim, and I kind of thought, well, let's take Larry Warren out of it. So that's the premise, and I'm not going to go in any further than that, but I took Larry out of the equation and said to myself, what evidence can I find to see if this event is as true as what he says? Yeah, so that's the premise, and all I can say is that I have gone into more depth than I did when I was with Holt, rightly or wrongly. Mm-hmm. And what I've uncovered, I think, is extraordinary on many levels, and information new and old will be a part of this documentary. And as I've said to a lot of people, the fact that it turned out to be an independent production meant that there was no TV money bias. So a big Channel 4, Channel 5, BBC or whatever, they would have had an agenda.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't have necessarily told the truth. They would have had an end agenda. Similarly, the negative TV bias against UFOs. Well, we ain't got that because there's nobody telling us what to do. So in a sense, this is like a free hand to tell the truth of what you've found in a way that nobody's probably ever done before, not on the scale and the quality of the production that we're doing. So my aim in all of this is just to tell the truth and put out what is there and what I've found. And believe me, what I found, new and old, is extraordinary. And I can say that absolutely that in the 50 to 60 documentaries ever made so far on Rendlesham, in a sense, proper documentaries, TV productions, none of them have ever addressed certain issues. None of them have ever done certain recreations. None of them have ever sought to do simple things that could have seen through a lot of these skeptical kind of explanations. And they were all so simple to do, but nobody's ever done them. Well, all I'm going to say on that is I'm addressing a lot of those issues in this film. And one of them you can actually see in the 5-minute trailer, which is the beautiful, absolutely stunning, beautiful use of drone photography, which is a relatively new phenomenon, not available until relatively recently. And we've got one of the top guys in Britain involved. And honestly, when I've only seen some of the rushes, but I've seen some of his work, and it's spectacular. And one of the things that I've always said to people about Rendlesham Forest is, once you've been there two or three times and you know what's what and where everything happened, kind of thing, ish, because nobody's that certain. Mm-hmm. But if you've ever been a couple of times, you'll soon realize that in many ways it's a bit like a tabletop exercise. It's a bit like walking around a miniature tabletop. It's a relatively small geographical area where all or most of the activity takes place. And it's certainly forest-wise. And I've always likened it to like a tabletop exercise because it is, to me, an extremely small area. And, you know, and when I remember saying to Colonel Holt, one of the first questions I said to him when I went away for 4 months and I came back, and again, I've said this, although it gets twisted by certain researchers, shall we say, but I said to him, your timeline doesn't add up. And his response to that was, I know.
Okay.
But he didn't tell me anything else. And that was right at the start of our relationship. So that would be sort of April 2008. And it was clear then that he didn't want to go and discuss what that meant. But I looked at his 4.5 hours based on his audio tape of being out in the woods. And again, for those people who have been there regularly, I defy anybody to be out there for 4.5 hours and not see a lot more than what has allegedly not been seen. It just doesn't add up, because in reality, it's a small area. And I really don't know where you go for 4.5 hours. You know, are they having a secret cup of tea somewhere for 2 hours? I don't know. It infers a lot of things, but the timeline doesn't add up.
No.
You cannot be out there for 4.5 hours, as he describes, in my opinion. There's something not right about that.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a couple of things I wanted to bring up about the documentary. The first one really being, and it's something that I'm sure you get every time you speak about the polygraphs, is you always get people saying, oh, polygraphs can be beaten. Now, I had a long conversation on the Friday evening of the conference in 2016 with Travis Walton. Yeah. We had a great conversation about polygraphs, and he enlightened me quite a lot. Now, I can't remember the specific details, but what would you say to anyone who says, oh, polygraphs can be cheated?
What I would say is that maybe historically the systems weren't in place, and maybe they weren't as accurate as they could have been. I am certainly not a polygraph expert in any way. I wouldn't even claim to know a lot about polygraph. In a sense, I hand it over to the experts. But I remember, I think the modern equivalent, what's deemed accuracy level, is something between 95 and 98% accurate. For those people who claim that they can be trained to beat it, like I'm a spy and they're training, maybe, I don't know. But I certainly don't think Larry Warren's a spy. So I think he just falls into me or you category. It's 95 to 90% accurate. We'll discuss those aspects in the documentary. But as far as I'm concerned, you have to, in a sense, you have to bow down to the experts. And we're talking about somebody who's done 2,000 tests and who makes a living out of it. Well, you know, why would the police user, both in the United States and the UK, why would private practice user in civil lawsuits if it was of no relevance? So to me, it doesn't really add up. And maybe historically in the past, there have been cases 20, 30 years ago where you could beat a polygraph test. But I really think that science has moved on. And when you see, as you did in the 5-minute trailer, you see very briefly Larry being hooked up to 5 different measuring devices. I could be sat on that and have those hooked up, and I would feel nervous, purely because humans do not like to be tested in that way over anything. Did you go to the toilet today? Yes or no? Kind of thing. Whatever it is, you'd still feel nervous because you're getting hooked up to unknown equipment that's outside your normal field of everyday life. So I think anybody would be nervous, but honestly, I have to bow to what I believe are the experts. And if you're the done 2,000 polygraph tests, you should listen to the experts. That's what I would say.
Yeah, that sounds pretty conclusive. The other thing I wanted to bring up was I remember very well a talk that you did at the Citizens Hearings on Disclosure. That was in Washington, D.C., 2013, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely right, yeah.
And I thought I'd got a pretty good handle on what happened at Rendlesham, as much as anybody had, if you like. But when I watched your talk there, I think there was a few technical issues.
You mean not the one that I gave during the actual testimony? You're on about the one that I did at night about Rendlesham Forest. Yeah, the private lecture. Yeah,
that to me was, it just blew me away with the detail that you went into and what you brought to that story. So
what I did there that was different, and it's probably the only time I've really only done it, maybe once after that, it was to bring emotion into it and try to recreate what was going on and what people were feeling like and how nervous and the adrenaline's pumping, especially when we talk about the third night where there's a lot of chaos. Well, what I would say is, I mean, that was 2013. But if I was to tell you that on a scale of 1 to 10, comparing what I knew in 2013 to what I know now, I would say no more than 30%.
Right, and
that means I know 70% more than I did.
Right, and that's the reason I'm so excited to see this film. I mean, I'll be honest, when I came down to Watford to meet up with you guys, and particularly to see Grant Cameron, I did try a little bit pumping Tino for some information, but he wasn't having none of it. You know, he'd just wink at me and with a little smile. But I don't blame him for that, you know.
Well, in a sense, I don't think there's anything wrong in saying that we want it to be well received, and I don't think there's anything amiss in saying that it's grown out of all proportions from what we originally started with. And in many, many ways, it will be extremely hard for the editor, who isn't me, is the director and editor, Dion. It will be extremely difficult for him, with so much material at his disposal, to put it all together, because we have such a wealth of material without going into it. You know, the sheer logistics, just in the time that you'll have for the documentary, whether it be 90 minutes, 2 hours, or whatever it turns out to be, it's going to be feature length. And given the amount of material that we've got, old and new, I don't know how he's going to do it. So, it's going to be an exciting process to see that come to fruition. But what I would say is it's better to have all the material more than less. But we have got some amazing interviews, amazing new facts, and I mean new revelations, and old revelations that I think have been conveniently forgotten about by I think parties that have got a said interest in keeping those things quiet.
Yeah. Also, we're talking about new information on Rendlesham Forest. One thing, I would be remiss if I didn't bring it up to you. Now, I don't know what your knowledge is on this particular aspect. So if you haven't looked at the information, then we're kind of a bit of a non-starter. But did you hear the interview that Wynne Keach did on Phenomena Radio a little while back?
I've not listened to it. I've been that busy. I am aware of it, and I think he comes up with a number of theories. Is that right?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you tell me what they are, and I'll go through the theory.
Sorry, say that again. We missed.
You tell me what he said, and I'll tell you what I think of the theory.
Well,
pressure on you, aren't it?
Sorry?
That's put pressure back on you, aren't it?
Oh, yeah. From my memory of it, I've only listened to it once, so I might be a little bit mistaken here, but from my understanding of it, Wynne was saying that there was a Russian satellite that, for some reason, the Americans wanted to bring it down. And there was some kind of a beam weapon being fired from somewhere in the UK, which seemed, as this beam fired at the satellite or just in front of it as it went past every time, it slowed it down a little bit. And eventually it slowed it down enough that it got on a re-entry path, and it eventually came down the forest. Russian special forces were in the forest, which we have heard little reports of Russians being in the forest, but nothing really concrete. But I thought it was a little bit strange in that he said, yes, this thing came down in the forest, which may explain certain parts of the story. But he also said it does appear that it seemed to rip a hole in time, space or something, and something else came through, which kind of, you know, it leaves the field wide open for absolutely anything there, doesn't it?
Well, what you always have to do, realistically, with any UFO event, is to match it against the testimony of the witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So somebody proposes a theory. It can be any theory. You have to always go back and does it match the testimony of that of the witnesses? This is just a general pointer, even with the police sightings. This is what I always do. And realistically, based on what you've just said, frog in my throat, excuse me.
No worries, mate.
Realistically, what you've just said, well, I haven't seen any evidence for that, but then I've not listened to his program, so I'm not going to prejudge that. But does it match a lot of the testimony that I am aware of, both old and new testimony from witnesses that I'm now aware of? And the answer is no, it doesn't. We are talking, I'm not saying that there could not have been something that crashed, that kind of scenario is possible. Although it doesn't match anything of the testimony, that may be something else. But what I'm saying is, from my point of view, when I had an interest in this case right from the off, because of my background in the RAF police and guarding nuclear weapons, and always knowing what it was like to work on those weapon storage areas, and we were guarding nuclear weapons like they did, that there must have been more witnesses. That was always my premise, because I knew that there was people walking around on foot in vehicles in the weapon storage area that nobody knows about. Well, if anything had come near that weapon storage area, as it was rumoured to be, then there would certainly be lots more witnesses. So that was always my initial take on it, and that's in a sense how I approached Holt the first time at the top of the tower. He did a video for me, and he said that basically what he said was that the guy in the tower had contacted him, not the other way around, and had told him that beams had been shone down into the weapon storage area, which, if true, would be, you know, questions in Parliament, which is what happened when it first was rumoured, when the case broke in October 93. In 83, when it came out, it got questions in Parliament, but nobody's ever put a name to it. So that's a major thing if that happened. Plus, it has the implications, were alarms going off, were the base going to react to it, what was going on, kind of thing. But for me, it's always been based on the accounts, as was that I knew, the principal accounts of Larry Warren, Holt, Penniston and Burroughs. They were the four principal people who were featuring the documentaries year in, year out, kind of thing. Well, all of those are talking about UFOs as far as I'm concerned. You know, when an object is stopping, moving, coming towards you, going away, that doesn't sound to me like it's some kind of Russian or satellite. Satellites cat, hover, stop, pulse, grow big, grow small, drop molten metal or appear to drop molten metal, divide five silently into five objects, as Holt describes. So for me, it was always a UFO event. And everything that I found out during the making of Capel Green convinces me even more that this is very definitely a UFO event, and is nothing prosaic, cobra mist, you know, Orford Ness lighthouses that have superpowers, giant formation rabbit teams, you know, making formation dancing landing patterns in triangular patterns, you know, very good Olympic rabbits that do that, but in reality, it's just a joke. This is always, for me, being a UFO event, and everything in my research points to it being very heavily a UFO event. Now, that's not to say what the UFO is, because ultimately I don't know, but we're talking about unknown aerial phenomena of very many types, with, and I would say collectively over the 3 or 4 nights, because we're still not sure whether it's 1 night, 4 nights, 3 nights. I think it probably is 4 nights, but we've got evidence for 3. But you've got some links to 4. But if you were to add up, in a sense, the number of witnesses who even peripherally, who were on the boat, on the base, or lights moving across the sky, zipping around, and not just security police. And I think this is a bit of a misnomer, is that people just think it's security police. Now, I think there's every reason to think that there was a lot of technical people out there at various times, especially on the third night. So I still think that if you were to add up the number of witnesses over the 3 or 4 days of activity, I would say you're looking at 100 plus, and that's a lot.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's. I mean, we've got, occasionally we get a new witness comes forward, but I mean, do you think there's really any realistic possibility of getting a lot more witnesses? Because it would seem obvious to anyone who looks into it in the depth that you have, and even only in the depth that I have, that there are more people aware of what went on. What do you think the chances are of getting a whole bunch more people talking rather than just dribs and drabs, one here, one there?
My own take on all of Rendlesham is that because if certain events were real, the implications would be profound, both for the British and American governments, if they were real and confirmed as fact. If those events were real, there would be real implications. It could be a trigger case for big D disclosure. It would certainly, because it's one of those top cases. If Roswell happened 10 years ago, it would have a lot more power than it does now. But that's not to lessen its importance. But Rendlesham is certainly one of those cases that has the potential to be a tipping point if certain things were to be established as fact and not rumour. And what I can say is that when you look at the Rendlesham case historically, a very strange thing happens. When the case first started to kick off, of course, you've got Dot Street, Brenda Butler, who quite rightly are recognised as being the first civilian investigators of the case, and did great work. They then teamed up with Brenda Butler. In the next few years, some American researchers got involved, and you know, and bits and pieces started to fall into place. Obviously, October 83, it hits the press, and then it becomes public to the worldwide media, and that sets off more people investigating. But I think, for me, as somebody that looks at UFOs and is a professional ufologist now with a magazine, is that when I look at cases around the world, I find it extremely rare that UFO witnesses then become investigators and then, in a sense, dominate and lead what I would say almost rival political factions. And I'm referring to Holt has a set viewpoint. You've got John Burroughs with his Phenomenal Radio Show has got often a different viewpoint to Holt. Larry Warren has never claimed to be a ufologist researcher. He just told his story through the book Left at Eastgate. And then you've got people like Jim Peniston, who at times comes in and out. He obviously did the book with John, appeared at the citizens' hearings, and now I think he's releasing a documentary and book on the binary codes. I believe that's in the works. I find those controversial. Personally, I don't believe them, and I've said that before. I think the timing was too iffy for me, the 30th anniversary. And the body language at the Woodbridge conference when it all came out, for me, was not good, and he made inconsistent remarks. But that's by the by. So what I'm saying is that if you look at the case historically, it's very unusual that the principal witnesses have become, in many ways, the principal investigators. Mm-hmm. And that is extremely unusual. And now, no disrespect to Jenny Randall's, to early American researchers, in a sense that they are not prominent anymore. They were perhaps in the 80s, early 90s, but they're, for whatever reason, they're not now. And the case is now essentially dominated by what I see is two political factions, which is the Holt faction, those who support him. And then essentially you've got Linda Moulton Howe and John Burroughs using their research and their in a sense, their research tool, which is the radio show, to try to encourage witnesses to come on. But I find that very unusual. And in some ways, I don't think it's healthy. And that is no disrespect to any of the witnesses, because they're good witnesses about their own events. But it's just unusual that that's happened. And I think in some ways, and especially in the last few years where some nasty kind of politics, I would say, has crept in, it's been used to create a very unhealthy debate about Rendlesham in general. And I think I think the factions have put a lot of people off. The casual observer who may have had an interest, I think they probably look in and go, I don't like that. I'm out of here. And who can blame them?
Absolutely, Gary. And for me, that whole thing, I mean, there's a very specific timeline that I became aware of, or I noticed, and it's so in your face for me. We went down to Woodbridge. Would that be 2014, 2015, when John and Larry spoke on the same stage? And
I was there as well with Richard Dolan. There was the four of us.
Absolutely,
2014,
yeah.
I think that one.
Yeah, Rich Dolan was quite amazing. He put me into a bit of a trance when he was speaking. That was very strange. It was like I was somewhere else, but I could hear every word that he was saying. That was really weird. But you noticed that there was a
genuine friendliness to all work together for a common end.
Cooperation that they were sharing.
John and Larry were fine at that time,
and then all of a sudden it all kicks off. Now for me, the fact that has caused this huge division in ufology in general, but in the Rendlesham
UK, yeah,
particular, surely that can't be a bloody accident. That's what the COINTEL, that's what they do. That's their stock in trade.
I mean, you're moving into areas that may be part of the documentary. Who knows? But I don't think you're wrong. And it's been very unhealthy. And without going into the trolling too much, what I would say is, if anybody wants to know the activities of certain trolls, then they just need to email me at heseltinegary@hotmail.com and I'll send them a 14-page PDF of their activities based on their own screen grabs, which I say, if you want it, just email me and I'll send it to you. And that in their own words, tells you what the links are and to who. And they do link to main players, or one of the main players, as it were. So that's, I think, all we're going to say on that. But, yes, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, and it is such a shame, because in 2014, everybody's smiling. I think at that time, or around that time, there's photographs on the net where Larry and John Burroughs are kind of like tongue-in-cheek pointing fun at the binary codes at Jim, you know, and everything is friendly and whatever. And it is just such a shame that it's not like that now. And it certainly isn't like that now. And from late 2014, things do change. And what a coincidence, I end my association with Colonel Holt at the end of 2014. So read between the lines.
Can I just say something, Gary? As somebody who's an outsider, I'm not really. Most of the stuff that you've been talking about throughout this interview with Andy has gone completely above my head. I don't really know very much about. I don't really know very much about it. But what I will say is, as somebody who has got friends in the UFO community, I was very surprised by the behaviour of certain people. I'm not going to mention anybody's name.
No, I don't think you need to.
I was really, really shocked at the behaviour, particularly when a lot of these people are supposed to be, you know, about enlightenment and, you know, and know it, you know, and about light and love and all that sort of thing. And I was just really, I really was shocked. I just wanted to say that.
No. And it's good because, I suppose Andy and myself have got a big interest in the subject, like people in ufology have. But if you're a casual observer looking in, people, I think, would be genuinely horrified by some of the infighting that was going on. And it's very unhealthy. And where I particularly drew a line, it was in life, everybody is going to have opposing views on some things. You know, especially when you think of politics and religion, they're the big two where, in a sense, you never mess with people's set views because they're almost an intrinsic thing, a part of growing up or whatever. And in the end, in society, we have begun to, well, for a thousand years anyway, we've lived in a society that basically says we'll agree to disagree in this forum of debate. Nobody's always going to agree, and healthy debate is good. And there will always be opposing views. The problem comes is that these people, you cannot have a healthy debate. You cannot have an opposing opinion that is different to theirs. Because if you disagree with them, then you become targeted and vilified because you disagree with them. And unfortunately, social media, for all its good things, this is a great platform, and this is social media in its positive aspect, that we can see each other, the technology is there, we can reach around the world. It's given people platforms to have their own shows in a way that they're not TV, that's not mainstream. That's the great positives of social media. But the real problem now is that there's a social media undercurrent that's allowed hatred and what I would call a kind of a form of terrorism and abuse to be in, that people can be absolutely awful. They can say anything. People are committing suicide. Children are committing suicide because they're getting bullied online over photographs, over Instagram photographs, little things like that. So we're living in a much different world than what you or I grew up into. And this is, and unfortunately, the legal side of policing social media, I would say, is probably 5 years running behind. And it, therefore, at the moment, they have created these fantastic methods in which you can communicate with people, but it's not policed well enough. And when you can threaten people, when you can say effing and blinding, and you can try to say their company is this, that, and the other, these people are conmen, liars, etc., blah, 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 without any kind of impunity from those that operate that platform, in reality, there's very little policing, then that is wrong. And this, I think, is changing. And I have no doubt in maybe 5 years' time, there will be criminal laws brought in just for social media. I know that they're talking about them, but I think there will be a whole raft of legal things that will be brought in the UK legislation, because they have to do more than what they're doing now, because it's wrong. If I was to suddenly say you're a paedophile on air, and like, you know, but these people kind of thing, say anything to grab attention, and they're in a sense getting away with it because of the loose policing of that, and it's absolutely wrong. People's careers can be destroyed. People have died, and that's the evil side of the incredible technology that's come with social media. So there's a flip side. On the good side, it's allowed fantastic interaction. You can reach people around the world. You can talk and see them in a way, messenger, whatever. But by the dark side, I would argue is far worse than the upside, because if you're on the wrong end of that and you're a victim of that abuse, then it's not policed well enough to manage it. It's absolutely wrong. And so that's, in a sense, what you get. And so these people who practice that, they are the people that can't have a conversation where you say, well, fair enough, I respect your opinions on religion. Mine are different. I'm an atheist or whatever, but I respect your views on religion and will agree to disagree. And that's how society deals with disagreement. You don't then go effing and blinding and this people, blah, blah, blah. Well, these people do. And for me, that is wrong. And that's the difference. You'll never hear me talking like that, but they do. And that's as simple as that. And it's indicative of a much wider issue of the very evil side of social media in its extremes. There's a lot of good, but there's also a lot of bad.
Andy, you might.
We can certainly vouch for that, Gary. I mean, we've had certain accusations, unfounded accusations directed towards, which essentially we just shrugged off and got on with it. But Davon Kleist, who made the 9/11 films, what was it, 9/11?
Ripple Effect and In Plain Sight.
And In Plain Sight. When we had him on, he was saying how he got sick of the 9/11 bowel movement, as he called it, and moved to Argentina for a self-imposed exile for over a decade.
Yeah.
He put something on social media the other day that I thought summed it up absolutely beautiful. And it was very simple. All he said was, social media, give everyone a voice and then no one can hear you. And that's the danger that we're really facing at the minute, because there is the signal to noise ratio is, we haven't got enough signal and we've got far too much noise at the minute.
Absolutely. And it's honestly, Facebook in particular need to employ a whole new division of cyber police with real powers, working in conjunction with all countries to police their people who use the platform, because it can be used for very evil effect as well as being used for very good effect. But that's that, you know, I that's the real sadness. And but there is something else maybe I want to add to that is. And I would have to say, and I'm going to say it without naming names, I've been very disappointed by some of the people who could have said more, who were in the UFO community, i.e. people in positions, not of power, but of influence, shall we say. And I've been very disappointed on the whole that these people have allowed some of these people to have a voice when really they should not have been anywhere near them, because they should have said, you're too extreme. I'm not having you effing and blinding. And plus, he's my friend. You're not talking about him like that, blah, blah, blah. You're supposedly researchers. Well, if you like a researcher, we'll act like one. And they haven't. And I feel let down to a degree and disappointed. And those people, I think, will know who I'm talking about themselves. But it's fair to say that they could have done more, they could have done much more 2 years ago, 3 years ago, to put a stamp on this right from the off. And they haven't, for whatever reasons. And I do feel as if they missed an opportunity to, in a sense, to stop the problem developing. They didn't. So the problem has developed. And ufology has been largely divided over the last 2-3 years as a result of their indifference. And in a sense, I kind of think that they're appeasers maybe frightened that they might get trolled too. Well, that's not a good enough reason. If they'd have all stuck together, as I hope they would do from the off, we wouldn't have had any of these problems. You have to have standards, and unfortunately, some people chose not to do anything.
You've certainly stirred our chat rooms up there, Gary, with your...
Am I saying things that are unreasonable?
you're saying that things that perhaps go against the principles of a lot of our listeners, they're really in favor of less policing, less laws. I think the vast majority of them want to return to common law and do away with acts and statutes.
I would argue that they're not living in the real world. As much as I can see their point of view, all of your life, all of my life, has been governed by statutes and laws that we've had to adhere to. Whether we like them or not is a different matter. But I do think that in a democracy, you have to have rules, otherwise you'd end up with chaos. And in a sense, this is a bit like what you're getting now on social media. You have chaos because it's not police. So in circumstances, what, you know, I don't want people not to have a voice, but I think there should be standards of what you can say about somebody, and it has to be factually true. I would never dream of calling you a con man, because that to me infers that you've got a criminal conviction for con man, as a con man. Now, that's what it would infer to me as a police officer if somebody called you a con man. And that is wrong, because where's my grounds for doing that? But these people, if they take a dislike to Andy Young, they'll go, there you go, is this, that, and the other. And they just think it's okay to say that. Well, it isn't okay to say that in those extreme terms, unless you've got the actual evidence to back it up. And that's what I mean by policing. Nobody, I'm all for freedom of speech, but it's how you say things. And we have to be civilized with each other and talk to each other in a personable manner. If we just, I mean, as a police officer, one of the things that you used to see with probationers is they go to an incident and they're young, they're keen, the adrenaline's flowing, and they're often a lot younger than the people that they're dealing with, maybe going to arrest with or arguing, fighting, whatever. And one of the kind of basic rules is go in soft. You can always go in, you can always raise the tone and go in harder. But when you're younger, your adrenaline's flowing, they can get it completely wrong, inflame the situation because they go way over the top, don't know how to talk to people, make the situation 10 times worse. Well, that's what I mean about ways and means. And these are the things that, in a sense, you find out in life. These are life processes. And unfortunately, you do have to have a degree of civility most of the time. And that's all I'm saying is you can say what you like, but you can still say it in a certain civilized way without having to revert to name calling, effing and blinding and threats.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying is wrong.
I think it's a sad indictment of how immature we are as a civilization, as supposedly a civilization, someone like you feels that there has to be a need for somebody to police it. I mean, we're grown ups.
We're not though, because we are grown ups, because we're treating each other with respect and having an interaction. That's the positive side of social media. But not ever, as you know, and as Andy knows, and I know, there's a lot of people out there who can think that they can just say anything, do anything, threaten anything, and call your names or whatever, that it can be very harmful. And that is not right.
No.
There has to be a way in which you deal with and interact. So you say that we're in a sense representing the good side of social media, but who represents those victims of the bad side? And that's where I say that there has to be policing, because unfortunately not everyone is mature, not everyone is civilized and can hold their tongue. Not everyone is mindful of everybody and respecting each other's opinions.
And that's the point that I was making, that it's sad that
it's
we are
so
immature. And I've had this theory that we're kept in a state of perpetual adolescence. So
I think social media was devised purely to dumb down people. It is a method to dumb down people. Let me give you an example of where I kind of always feel really sad. I've always been a film buff, right? And I love films. And I used to get all the magazines, and I used to be always doing quizzes at work and whatever. And when the first internet came, I got my first computer, I think it would have been probably about 1988, and it was a big thing. You know, I was really excited. And this idea of word processing and that you could reach out through chat rooms to people around the world. Wow, this was exciting. And I remember going on to AOL and waiting for it to connect and all the strange noises that you'd have to go before you finally got through. And I set up chat rooms to have film discussions and just have proper debate about this, that, and the other. And within 5 minutes, I guarantee you that somebody came in with an innuendo, stupid, mindless comment. And then after that, it just disintegrated. So the best will in the world, it just doesn't work. Mm. And so chat rooms, as good as they are, largely don't work because you get a few idiots who come in there, trivialize it, make a joke of everything. Everybody jumps on the bandwagon of the joke and it descends into childish chat. And that's, in a sense, I think, indicative of the way that we are dumbed down and we are, in a sense, not able to police ourselves. Yeah?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Completely agree. I completely agree. Listen, we've gone a little bit over time. So we usually have a break at about the hour mark. We've gone 6 minutes over, so I'm just going to play one record. So if anybody wants to get yourself a drink or you need to relieve yourself or anything like that, I'm going to play one record and we'll be back. It's Raconteurs News on Tuesday night. Andy Young and Jason Holmes with Gary Heseltine, and I'm going to play a record. Enjoy the break.
It's close to midnight. Something evil's lurking from the dark. Under the moonlight, you see a sight that almost stops your heart. You try to scream, but terror takes the sound before you make it. And you start to freeze as someone looks you right between the eyes. You're paralyzed, cause this is daylight and no one's gonna save you. You hear the door slam and realize there's nowhere left to run. You feel the cold and wonder if you ever see the sun. You close your eyes and hope that this is just imagination.
In the room, wife's just come back from work.
Okay,
that was a gone man. Interesting discussion,
brilliant.
But one thing having freedom of speech is another having abuse. And that's wrong.
Together, 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 together,
Darkness falls across the land. The midnight hour is close at hand. Creatures crawl in search of blood to terrorize your neighborhood. And whosoever shall be found without the souls all getting down must stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell.
That, of course, is Thriller, Michael Jackson. Welcome back to Raconteurs News on this Tuesday evening. We've had a great show so far. I've learned loads and loads and loads. I'm mostly taking a back seat on this one because this is Andy and Gary's turf, but I'm occasionally chipping in there. Let me just, I hope you enjoyed that song. I had a bit of a dance myself. The one good thing about being in a wheelchair is it's dead easy to moonwalk. So you just have to push yourself backwards. Anyway, we're back. But where are we going next, guys? I'm going to hand it over to you, Andy, and Gary, and just tell us where we're going next.
Well, where I'd like to take it next, if that's okay with you, Gary, is, I mean, we've touched on social media, the ills and the pitfalls, and where I'd like to go next is the Home Firth Conference, because I believe this year is your sixth one, and you've got something pretty special lined up this year. So if you can give us a bit of a rundown on what's going on there, and whether you've got any tickets left, because I know one or two of our listeners are coming up to meet me and Jason. So if there's anybody else wants to come along, whether they can buy tickets. So
what I can say to you on the tickets is there's about 50 tickets each day left. First come, first serve. Once they're gone, they're gone. It's not a huge venue, but it's a great venue in terms of where it's located, in terms of the infrastructure around it, cafes, bars, shops, restaurants all around it. So that's why I keep it there. A lot of people say to me, you could go to bigger venues. And I probably could, but then I wouldn't have the infrastructure of the town. And I like to bring business to the town. For those that have been going for the last few years, it's become a part of the calendar in Home Firth. I mean, it's Home Firth is a touristy town because of the Last of the Summer Wine, the long-running comedy series. And basically, they will have an art festival, a film festival, etc., a beer festival. And now, in a sense, we have a UFO weekend. And when I first started 6 years ago, the people in the shops, when I took flyers around, they would just laugh at me. UFOs? Are you crazy? But now we book up the whole weekend. People travel overseas to come to the conference, and all the accommodation gets booked up very quickly, months in advance. So people now probably would have to go to Huddersfield, 7 miles away. But yeah, they love us now because we take over the town. And Andy, you've been there pretty much often. I think you can vouch for the fact that there's a really good atmosphere in the town over that weekend.
Yeah, I've been to, I think the first one we went to was the second one, because the first we heard about the first one was when we saw a YouTube video of you and Richard all talking about it. So, as soon as we heard about the second one, we booked as soon as we heard. We was a little bit late booking, so we ended up with accommodation about 5 miles away from the venue. So for me, I would say to anyone who's looking at going for the weekend, book as soon as you possibly can. Obviously, this year, if you haven't got tickets now, you're going to be at the tail end. But for next year's conference, get booked as soon as you can, because it really, to me, it's vital as part of the social side of the whole thing to get in the town centre, to get a hotel within walking distance of the bridge where everyone meets up on the night time, and you can actually mingle with the speakers and have a I mean, it blew me away the year before last when we arrived, I don't know, 7-8 o'clock in the evening. Larry gave us a big hug as we walked through the door, and he's like, come over here, talk to Travis and Nick Redfern. And we spent the evening talking to Travis and Nick Redfern and Kate. And that evening just blew me away. It was so worth it being in the center of town just for that evening. And it makes the whole weekend for me. But
well, if the weather's good, it's always dependent British weather-wise. But if the weather's good, and it obviously has been a fantastic summer so far, so hopefully it won't be raining, people sit out till 2-3 in the morning, especially outside the bridge, because they've got a lot of seating outside. And for the first time, for a lot of people, perhaps maybe 20% or 25% of people who come to the conference have never been to a conference before. And I always, after the conference, they always write to me and say, oh, look, this is my first ever conference. It was fantastic. And we met so many like-minded people, felt comfortable, and we sat and chatted till 2-3 in the morning, as you can. Now, it's not very often in the UK that you have multiple day events on UFOs. And so that's what I say. This is the proper, it's an intimate, I don't want it in a bigger venue, but it's intimate. I've tried to create a family atmosphere, and people always come back and say that that's what's been achieved, so which is nice for me. And it's so good because all the infrastructure is around you. Your shops, bars, restaurants, cafes, they're only a matter of 100 meters away from the venue. So there's always places to go to. We take over the town Friday, Saturday, Sunday. A lot of people now arrive on a Thursday night and go back on a Monday. So they make it, you know, they're booking cottages, B&Bs, apartments, and we've become a part of the social fabric of the town, which is good because they earn in revenue as much as I am putting on the conference. I love it. And, you know, for me as the conference host, I never get to quite enjoy it as you do, as people that attend, because I'm obviously thinking about everything all the time. You never switch off as a conference organizer. But, you know, I enjoy the fact that other people get such a big thing out of it. And it's nice for me when I get the feedback after the conference. It's always good.
Mm. Well, I believe I said to you, I think I said to you 2 years on the trot, when you got Stan Freeman there, I said, whoa, that's going to be a tough one to follow. And then, of course, you topped that. You got Travis there the following year. And I said to you at the end of that, how the hell are you going to top that? Last year, you didn't, there wasn't such a big name as Travis there, I don't think, although Kathy Marden comes quite close. But for me, the whole atmosphere, the professionalism with which you guys do it, it just makes it a riveting weekend. And
that's very kind of you to say that. I mean, you try to, in the end, you're trying to create entertainment and get people, hopefully, to enjoy themselves. I never get bad feedback. It's always positive feedback. Maybe the people who've got bad feedback just don't contact me, but it's always positive after the conference. But I mean this year's lineup is pretty special. If you want, I can start going through the speakers.
Yeah,
by the way, we're talking Saturday the 15th of September and Sunday the 16th September, two full days. The program is out on the website and will be linked to Andy's page along with the poster. But let's have a look. For the first time, I've kind of introduced an ancient alien theme. That's because I've always been interested in the ancient alien concept. I don't agree with everything that's said, but I certainly agree that ET has been coming here for a long time. And I think they have played an active part in human development. I certainly suspect that. And I think they've been coming here for thousands of years. When you look at petroglyphs all around the world that you can't explain, that are thousands of years old and they look like they're wearing spacesuits, et cetera, et cetera. And it's common to all most cultures that it's the sky gods coming down, blah, blah, blah. So I decided this year to do something a bit different. But for me, it's just an extension of ufology, which is the ancient alien arm, in the same way that you've got crop circles, you've got mutilations, etc. I think that the ancient aliens is just another branch. It's the first branch, in a sense. And so in that vein, somebody who I've never met and looking forward to meet is Brian Forster. who is a regular for posting lost technology videos, especially in South America. He lives in Peru, American now, lives in Peru. And I'm fascinated by his work on Tiwanaku, Pumapunku, places like that, places that I'd like to go to at some point before I die. and I've been fascinated. And so he's a regular on the Ancient Aliens TV series, been in most of the series, I would think. And so he's a regular, so he's come across, and he'll be talking about ancient aliens and obviously lost technologies, which I'm fascinated by, because to me it's obvious that we have had either influence or help with building things in the past, and that things have been machine cut and not hammer and chisel, as kind of like, or rock and chisel, as has been described. The sheer logistics of some of the weights I find incredible, especially when you start moving over terrain, bringing stones that weigh 60 tons 60 mile over up and down dale on supposed rollers. But I don't think there's any clue in reality to support that, because if you take it back to this, you take it back to its very basic things, where have we ever attempted to take anything over 5 miles, let alone, you know, there's the log experiments that do over flat ground with 100 people pulling on logs on absolutely flat ground, and it works for about 100 meters and it kills them all. But try doing that up and down dale, it just won't work. So you know, and there were no roads then, there were big stones everywhere. So to my mind, it's just nonsensical. But anyway, so Brian Forster, Lost Technologies, Ancient Aliens. And then and somebody then who is in the same ilk, which is Andrew Collins, UK based. I met him for the first time at Glastonbury, I think in 2014, something like that, 2015. And I've admired his work, and he's a regular on Ancient Aliens. So the two of them together, I think, make a very powerful duo on that aspect that I tried to introduce to the conference. He'll be talking about one of my, again, bucket list places, which is a place called Göbekli Tepe in Turkey. And that's a place I'd like to go to, even though it's near to the Syrian border and you might get killed kind of thing, but I'd like to go. He regularly takes people there, so I might chat to him over that. But he's going to be talking about that and lost technologies, ancient aliens, etc. So that's the ancient alien side of things. Then, in a sense, I'm one of these people who firmly believe that Roswell was real, that we recovered a UFO, that it was almost certainly ET. And a lot of the things that have come from that, I think the fiber optics, I believe all that. I think we've reversed engineered bits. I think we've probably have even got bits of the machinery working. I think we have been able to reproduce man-made UFOs in experimental form, not widespread, but I think we've got like an Illman Imp to a Rolls-Royce version. That's the way I would look at it. We've got it to fly, but maybe not with the full application of what they have. So anyway, the reason why I approached Don is because I do not want people to forget about Roswell. And yes, it's the name is synonymous with a UFO event, but as years are going by, because this happened in 1947, July 1947, we are looking at an event that in a sense could be forgotten by younger people. And I don't want that to happen because it's such a good case. And he is one of the preeminent three or four people in the world, written many books about it. And he's a very good speaker. So Don Schmidt, to me, is one of the top guys to tell you about Roswell. And, you know, and I remember having a meeting him several times. And I think he said to me once, something like 600 or 700 witnesses have played a part, however big, small, in the actual telling of the Roswell story. Well, that's a lot of people. And I think there is a story there to tell. So that should be fascinating for people to hear it from one of the top experts. The next speaker, most people, unless you're an ardent ufologist or researcher, probably won't be aware of that much, and that's a guy called Robert Fleischer. But Robert Fleischer is pretty well known in Europe. maybe not in this country, but he regularly appears at conferences in Europe, and he is from Germany, and he is, I think, without a shadow of a doubt, Germany's top UFO researcher. I met him for the first time, I think it was 2015, when he invited me out to Leipzig, which is where he lives, in what was old pre-Iron Curtain East Germany. But Leipzig was beautiful, and he looked after me well, and that was just to do a lecture there for him and his group. And he runs like his own YouTube channel, and he has considerable more difficulties in trying to get people to come forward in Germany than what you do get in Europe, the rest of Europe, especially in Britain. We think we're hard done to, but I should say almost now there's a daily story in one of the national newspapers about UFOs, or every week certainly there will be, which is a lot different from how it used to be. But in Germany, the subject there is almost universally poo-pooed for whatever reason, and he battles much harder to try to get people to come forward and get stories into the media. It's very repressed in Germany. Quite why that is, I don't know. I think it may be a remnant from the German Nazi Second World War past, and the fact that they were experimenting with circular aerial platforms, UFOs, for want of a word, in the late 40s, in 44, 45. But for me, I don't believe the stories that they were flying these things left, right and centre, because if they had, I think they'd have won the war. They didn't. They may well have got one or two prototypes flying, but I think that was largely all snatched by the British and the Americans at the end of the war, and who knows where that technology went. But, you know, when people talk about, you know, did that lead to America having UFOs in the 50s and 60s, man-made UFOs? No, I don't think it did, because you had the Avro car, which was a massive program in the early 60s, and it never got more than 3 foot off the ground. So if they'd have had that technology, they'd have done a better job. So unless that was a public relations exercise, which is not impossible, but I don't think so, to be honest. So I'm not one of these people that believe that the Nazis had UFOs flying around that could do incredible things. I think they maybe had a lot of patents for circular aerial platforms, but I don't think they ever got to the operational stage, as it were. Maybe one or two flew. In fact, I could tell you, really, the best account I ever heard for the reality of at least one craft that flew was, I think in 2012, I did a lecture in Odense, in Denmark, and before I did my lecture, a guy came up to me who was in his, I guess, late 70s, early 80s then, and he told me a story which sounds incredible, but I had no reason to disbelieve it. And he basically said that he was a teenage boy riding a cycle in the latter days of the war, in Denmark, and basically he was riding on a road, and there were forests on either side of the road, and then he said this object came up from the forest that looked like one of the Hanabu type design Nazi UFOs, for want of a better word. And he said that then two British fighter planes came and shot at it, and it disappeared at speed. And he told it in such a believable way. And you think, well, why are you going to make up a story like that? But he said it was not a conventional plane. And to all intents and purposes, he'd spent many years trying to identify who the British pilots were, but never quite got success, but had spent many years trying to bottom it. So, I mean, why would you do that? Spend many years trying to track it down if it was not a real event. So to him, it was something certainly profound, and that's a compelling story. And when I heard it, I thought, well, that's maybe the one exception where I think, well, maybe they did get something flying.
If I can just briefly, didn't he
chat room. They're asking whereabouts in Denmark was that? Sorry.
Or Dens. O-D-E-N-S-E, as we would spell it. It's the birthplace of Hans Christian Andersen. Just put in that. So it's his birthplace, because I went to his house that took me to his little museum of a house. So, yeah, so that was then. And I always remember that, because the guy was so sincere. He had a big scrapbook, and he showed me all the letters he'd done trying to identify the pilots, and never quite succeeded. But I thought to myself, well, why is he going to make up this story and spend so many years trying to prove something? And I think it was because it was true. So whatever he saw certainly does appear to have been some, you know, it might have been ET, I guess, but he said it was likened to the shape of the what was classed as a Hanabu UFO, Nazi UFO. So who knows? But that's the most credible account I've heard. Right, back to the conference. We digress. Then after that, you have a witness who doesn't speak much now. He's doing a few lectures this year, because he's brought his book out, which is Alan Godfrey, the former police officer who I first met, I think, in 2003. But for those people who aren't aware of Alan Godfrey or his story, cutting a long story short, he had a sighting in November of 1980, just a few weeks before Rendlesham, in West Yorkshire, in Todmorden, in West Yorkshire, a little town. And he basically was driving his police car, and he saw an object, flying saucer, for want of a better word, hovering in the road, 5 feet off the ground, blocking the road. He went to use his radio, it was dead. He went to use his personal handset, it was dead. He then did a sketch of it. He then thought, I'm going to go have a look at this thing, got out of the police car. And then he thought, no, bugger that, I'm going to go back in the police car. Got a bit frightened. And then the next thing, he is driving 100 yards further down the road. Object's gone. It's like there's been a time jump. Spins the car around, goes back, and it'd been raining in the night. And it's November, so there's a lot of twigs. And he said he described the bottom half of it as rotating anti-clockwise, and the centrifugal force, because it was only about 5 feet off the ground, had created a circular pattern of branches and leaves. He picked up another police officer, took him there, and told him. And the guy was a bit skeptical at first, but he said, "Look, there's the pattern." And it'd been raining in the night, and there it is, this circular patch, and it was noticeably drier inside the circle than outside. So it seemed to account for what he was saying. I'm just letting the dog out. Go on. And basically, cutting a long story short, it went in the local paper because the local press found out. And he told it as it was, and he got a bit of ridicule, but it largely went away. But then a few months later, he was approached by a British researcher of some renown, and played some significant parts in Rendlesham. It was a guy called Harry Harris, who was a Manchester-based solicitor and also a UFO researcher. And he went to see him with another police officer called Norman Collinson, who was an active police officer at the time, a senior officer, and said, "Will, I'm going to have to let my dog in again." Temperamental. He said, "Would you be hypnotized? Because we think that you know, you might have more memories. You might be able to retrieve more memories." And at first he said no. Cutting a long story short, a few months later they went back to him again and said, "Have you changed your mind?" He was having a few nightmares, so he said, "Okay." Then that led to 4 sessions, approximately 3 months apart, over the next year, 1981, and on each occasion under hypnosis he came out with the same story. Cutting a long story short, he was in the missing time jump gap. He was found himself in a room being examined by small creatures that were putting machinery on his legs, and he described them as lamp heads, bulb heads, 3 to 4 feet high. It looked like children, but they weren't children. Which the significance of his story is fascinating, because it was just at the same time that Communion was coming out, the Whitley Strieber book with the what we now would regard as an iconic grey alien head on the front cover. And basically, he experienced something like that, but described them in a very unique way, lamp head bulb heads. But that's not a million miles from the big kind of like V-shaped head. And literally, when that went in the national news, and there's a convoluted story as to how that happened, he then was thrust into the glare of the world media. He went on, you know, breakfast TV with Frank Boff in uniform. He did a lot of media interviews, documentaries, but his life turned, I should say, in a bad way, because he got a lot of ridicule. His police force were very harsh on him, and he'll go into that. But the significance of Alan's story is that I would regard Alan's story as being Britain's first well-documented and well-publicized alien abduction account in Britain. So we're talking 1980, and this was long before the X-Files, long before what we know now of experiences, contactees, however you want to regard them, whatever name you want to put on them. But you know, I researched his story for about 18 months on and off, met a lot of the police officers. He was a well-regarded police officer, and he had a lot of suffering as a result of going public, and I don't think he ever expected the glare of publicity to be quite as hard on him as it was, which is in itself is a great story. And he threatened kind of like to write a book for years. Well, he's finally done it now. I think he's had help with Jenny Randalls, who's a well-respected British researcher. She helped him kind of like translate, I think, his account, the rich detail of his account, and helped him, I think, co-write the book. So that is out, and it came out last year. And as a result, he's doing a few lectures, but he doesn't do many, and I don't think he will do that many more. So this is a unique opportunity to hear of, I think, Britain's best abduction story. In fact, there's a little story that his story was optioned for a Hollywood film, in the same way that Travis Walton's Fire in the Sky. Well, the same producer loved Alan's story. And in the end, they chose to go with Travis's story, which was made into a successful Hollywood film with James Garner called Fire in the Sky. But apparently the producer sent him, or the writer-producer sent him a card, because they stayed in touch for a while afterwards. And he said, I wish I'd made your story instead of Fire in the Sky. So that's how good Alan's story is. So that's a pretty good way to advertise Alan's story. Okay, so two more speakers, myself. Well, I think you know enough about me, so I'll be talking about the Pentagon admissions and their implications, which we can maybe touch on in a bit, although we're running out of time. But there is a significant, new person who has never, ever, ever, ever spoken in front of an audience before, and he's called Steve Ungero, and he is from a Rendlesham point of view, he is a new witness to go on camera. His name was mentioned by Larry Warren because he said he was with him at some point in the night's event. I'll give credence to thanks to Philip Mantle. He approached him first and got a brief interview with him that was early last year, which was good. But unfortunately, from Steve's point of view, it was about 6:30 in the morning, and so he was not perhaps as coherent as it was with the time difference. That's what he said to me. So anyway, on the strength of that, I contacted Steve Longero based on what he'd said to Philip. And obviously, I was an advanced interviewer of suspects and witnesses, and about training, I tried kind of retrieve memories and things like that. Well, it's not designed in any way for an event that's 38 years ago. It's not designed for that at all. It's designed for murder, manslaughter, rape, that kind of thing. However, you still have memory tools that you can maybe use. And the biggest aspect, I'll put the light on because I think I'm going dark here. I think the aspect that's most interesting is that you don't forget those, that training that you've had. And realistically, I said to him, I know you've done this for Philip Mantle. I said, but I've got a feeling you know more. I didn't mean that in a critical way. I said, would you let me try to kind of get you to concentrate and see where it goes? And there's no hypnosis. You can't do hypnosis transatlantic via a telephone call. But anyway, so he agreed to do that. And what I'm not going to go into detail because it's obviously going to be a part of the Capel Green, because what he said in a number of areas is truly significant. Certainly one of them will be if you go back and not give you the clue now, you're gonna have to, if you've been listening to this show, audience, listen in now and play it back, because I gave you a clue earlier on in the show, and I said that once upon a time there was a story about questions being asked in Parliament and what triggered that. Well, then maybe that's a clue, what this man might say. But there you go. He's going to come up with a couple of major things. And the interview that we did took about three hours or so. And he really, really concentrated for me. He really got in the zone. And that's where we were able to get some more information, which I think is significant. Now, originally, and again, this echoes what we said right at the start, how the Capel Green movie had grown in its scale and scope. Originally, we were hoping to have the documentary aired by September this year, i.e. for the conference. We was hoping to even play it at the conference, but it's just not possible because the amount of people that's been involved in it and the fantastic interviews that we've assembled. So it's going to be released in the spring of 2019. If anybody asks that, it will be released now, Capel Green, in the spring of 2019. And if you go to the website, www.capelgreen.co.uk, it says that it's the spring of 2019. And it's just because of the scale and all the post-production things that you've got to do to make that happen. Steve is a part of that project. But obviously, we find ourselves in a situation where he's actually here. And I've said there's no point in bringing him across for him not to tell what he's going to tell. So this is going to be a closed session. There'll be no cameras. The audience is in for a treat. Now, the fact that he has never spoken publicly, or ever given a lecture, I think would be a bit daunting for anybody. So I have said the easiest way for him to feel as comfortable as he can, and I'm sure he will be very nervous, is to do it like a one-on-one on stage, like I've done with David Kate, and like I've done with Stanton Friedman, AJ Gerard, Kathleen Marden, you know, and that'll be the easiest way to bring the significance of his story out. And as I said, people are in for a right treat. And if you are really interested in the Rendlesham story, you want to be there, because this is going to be a significant development in a certain number of areas. So that's all I can say on that, but you'll not be disappointed. So as I say, that's the conference. Tickets are available online. All you have to do is go to the magazine website, which is www.ufotruthmagazine.co.uk. Go to the relevant conference home for the conference page, and all the prices are listed. There are two types of prices. Basically, there are weekend conference tickets, which are for those that are discounted slightly for those who are magazine subscribers. And if you're not a magazine subscriber, then you need to click on the non-subscriber option. You can buy 1-day ticket, 2-day tickets. You can even get a couple of vendors tables are still left for the venue, so have a look. But honestly, if you're going to miss out on a treat if you don't go, and these are top quality people, you know. I don't know when the last time Brian Forster spoke in the UK. I mean, he's always going off with his hidden Inca tours all around South America and all over the world, but he doesn't. I don't think he's ever spoken at a UFO conference before. This is a UFO conference, but I've incorporated the alien aspect because it's another branch of the subject for me. And so he's quite excited about that. And all being well, I'm going to say that there may well be a bit of an announcement made in relation to Brian and I at some point in the future. That's all I'm going to say on that. It might not happen, so but hopefully we're in talking about something which hopefully will come to fruition, and we may be in a position to talk about it at the conference. Obviously I've never met him yet, so it'll obviously be better in real life to meet with him and discuss things. So we'll see where that takes us.
Okay, that's about covered the conference. Can I throw questions at you? You've got from the chat room, Gary.
Yeah, okay. I'm not a con man. Hang on a minute. I'm not a con man. I'm not a liar. I'm not a fraud. And I'm going to give you more information about Reynolds and Forrest in this documentary than has ever been given to the public before. That's my promise to the public.
Excellent. And we'll hold you to that promise for certain. One of the questions we've got, I can't remember who posted it. They wanted to know what your feelings are on Stephen Greer and the Disclosure Project, Gary.
Complicated, really. My feelings, the original Disclosure conference in 2001 was brilliant, mm-hmm. in the sense of if that was his idea, it was brilliant to get military people, in a sense, really high caliber witnesses together. That was a brilliant concept, and it's much, I would agree with all of that. Over the years, though, I've seen what I would say is a change in Stephen Greer, in the sense he's become a very slick money making machine. Nothing wrong with making money, but that's how I see it. Let me give you an example of where I think it's where I was a bit surprised. At the citizens' hearings, obviously I was one of the 40 speakers giving testimony, and so they had like a green room with teas and coffees and a few biscuits in the back for the speakers. Well, I think I was a bit shocked when he walked in with his own private security in uniform just to protect him, and I thought, well, as Michael Jackson walked in, you know, because I could understand Michael Jackson having his own security, but I'm not sure a UFO researcher, I quite understand that. But yes, so that kind of made me think, well, there's nothing wrong with ego if it's used in the right way. I have an ego. Anybody who does this job has an ego, as long as it's handled right. But I've met him twice now. And where I kind of hit a question mark with him was, and I've not had a falling out with him or anything, but in the run-up to the citizen hearing, he had been trailing his documentary Sirius, and I reckon for about a year he was making regular YouTube videos saying, we finally got ET, we recovered an alien body, it's unique, it's been examined, this is ET. And for a year he said, this is ET, this is ET, this is ET. And he, I was skeptical of that, but I kind of hoped that he had, because it would be great if there was a breakthrough, whoever gets it out. But anyway, I kind of then question why he, having said that it's ET, ET for a year, he must have known that it wasn't ET when that film premiered. And that, when did that film premiere? Do you know, Andy?
It was either immediately before or immediately after the citizens' hearings, because I was exactly the same.
It was a week before.
Yeah, it seemed to take the wind out of the sails of the citizens' hearing very successfully.
Yes, and he had loads of media attention building up, because he'd said it's ET, it's ET. So eventually, even the most ardent sceptical newscasters thought, well, he might just have hit the jackbox. You know, jackpot here, And so he had a lot of coverage for when he released that film. And the premiere was this big hoo-ha. Good luck to him, but it turned out not to be E.T. So that just killed all the mainstream media dead, in my opinion. And I have to look at it cynically and think, was that done for a reason? And that's my logical question. The week before the citizens' hearing, there was very, very little mainstream coverage of the in terms of TV cameras there every day. Unlike his disclosure conference that had, I think, the biggest audience ever of TV cameras ever in the National Press Club. And the serious movie just killed any mainstream coverage of the citizens' hearings. And I thought, well, why couldn't you have waited a week? The citizens' hearings, of which he was a part, and he was one of those giving testimony, was so important. Surely he could have delayed it a week afterwards to see if we could attract the best coverage. And I just kind of doesn't sit well with me that it was a week before. And it to me, it brings up the hint that it killed off purposely the coverage of the citizens' hearings, which is still the best thing I've ever been involved in, by the way. Because we did try to do it the right way. It was done like a mock congressional hearing. And it's the proudest thing that I've ever been involved in ufology-wise. And I still think that when big disclosure happens, whether it's 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, but it's coming, that will be seen as a seminal key moment on that path to disclosure. And the people, I think, will be recognized for what we tried to do then. Apart from Nick Pope, who should have never been in it, because he was the only one of 40 people to say, well, I'm not sure.
Yeah, Nick was a bit of an odd one to put in there. But that great answer, Gary. One of the other questions we've got been asked in a couple of different ways. I believe it was Webby said he's convinced that the visitors are interdimensional rather than extraterrestrial. Somebody else was saying, are they from out there or are they actually from here?
All good questions and absolutely all possibilities are up on the table. I'm not one of these people that says they're this, that and the other. I think if you follow this subject like I have for 40-odd years now, you can't just have a nuts and bolts component. I'm very much a big believer that there are structured machines flying around because plenty of pilots see structured machines. But quite where they're from, are they interdimensional, multidimensional? Are they from the past, present, the future? Who knows? But I look at the huge abduction phenomena, which is real, whether people like it or not, it's real. You know, and I always say to people, well, even in the third world where they don't have access to TV, radio, any books, video, YouTube or whatever, they still come out with the same account. So how can that happen without no external stimuli other than the real thing? And so if you look at the millions and millions of people around the world who claim to be in contact, and people like Susan Hansen, who writes for the magazine, she's a contactee, experiencer. AJ Gibbard did. Robert Salas has come out and said that he's had experiences. So, you know, are we just to say these people are crazy? Well, no, I don't think they are. And it makes perfect sense to me, as I often try to tell people, that the Earth is a bit like the Great Barrier Reef. That's the way I term us. We're like the Great Barrier Reef. When we go to the Great Barrier Reef, we're mindful not to break off the coral. We just watch the pretty fish in their local habitat, and we surveil them and watch them in, you know, and just wonder at the beautiful sea life that's there. Most of the time, we do not interact with them at all. We just watch and surveil. Well, I think that's what most species of ET do to us, as we would do to them if we suddenly found that there were a species of alien life on Mars, and it was publicly acknowledged, and there were like rabbits walking around on Mars. We'd be sending film crews there if we could technologically do it to get them in their natural habitat. That's what we would do if we discovered a new type of rodent or a new type of chimpanzee. We'd send people where we could to film them, but some people would, you know, try to collect them Some people probably try to steal them for their private collections. So you get into, I've got quite a lot of theories on this, but that I liken us to the Great Barrier Reef. Most species just watch, and we're the ants on the in the playground. Would we talk to an ant on the playground? We would not, because we think we're far too superior. Well, what if we are the ant in terms of evolution, and there's a civilization that's a million years ahead of Earth? We may be that ant, and there's not, that's why they don't make contact as such. But some contact is ongoing, hence why you've got experiencer abduction phenomena going on. Some species clearly are not nice. If you look at alien, if you look at animal mutilations, well, those cows, sheep, dogs, whatever animal it is, they're all getting mutilated. I guess that's not a good thing. There are even stories of human mutilations, not many, but there are a few credible ones. And so obviously at least one species may have a genetic program ongoing. In fact, Tim Good once told me, he said he'd been told, and he's very eminent, he doesn't do much now, he's retired, but he told me in 2013 at the first magazine conference in Home Firth, he said he'd been told by a high-level source that there was a 100-year genetic program going on, which would account for the mutilations that were going on all around the world. He said, but the problem is we don't know when it begins, when it began. So it might be 70 years off, it might be next year, who knows? But who and what are the ramifications if it ends, and what's going to happen then? Do they then say, well, that's it, we've harvested a new species based on this 100-year program, here we go, we're taking over now, who knows? So I think most ET is benign, otherwise they would have taken over a long time ago. We should not, and I know that time is running short, we should not forget and mention the incredible Pentagon admissions on December 16, 2017, because for the first time since 1969, they admitted that they've been doing secret UFO research, UAP research, but it was the Pentagon saying this. They'd put $22 million into it over 5 years between 2007 and 2012. But the significant, absolutely significant thing to come out of that was when, in a Pentagon authorized admission, they say there are things flying around in our airspace, i.e. the American airspace, that's way beyond our technology, and they aren't ours. Now, most of the time, the TV people who were interviewing people did not ask that question, well, if they're not ours, whose are they? But it did happen a couple of times, and one of the pilots who was involved in the USS Nimitz event, which was the little video, the tic-tac video that they put out, which was an event in 2004, he did a lot of TV interviews, and some of them did ask him, and he said, well, I'm like a Top Gun pilot, I've flown in some like 80 odd aircraft, if you're asking me what they are, based on what I've seen, it's extraterrestrial. You can't get it any clearer than that. So you should not forget those December admissions. They're absolutely small disclosure with a small d, but it will be seen, like the citizens' hearings, as being a crucial moment on the timeline to big D disclosure.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Gary. Been a fascinating question. I haven't been through all of everybody's questions, and I apologize to everybody whose questions I couldn't.
If there's a quick one, you've got 2 minutes left. Is it till 9 o'clock, or do you run over?
Go on then, we'll give you a quick one. Alana Green asked me, can I ask you what your thoughts on Trump's announcement of a space force?
Interesting. And you know, Trump is obviously a very controversial president, and I would agree that he's controversial. In one way, I'm very pleased, because I want us to go back into space. But it's a whole new regime, and quite why it's been brought in. And it begs the question, what do they know that we don't? Put it this way, do I think there's a secret space program? Probably. But do I believe in people like Corey Good? Well, not enough evidence backs that story up. So the answer is not corroborated yet. But there is probably a secret space program. But we need to know a lot more. But are we going back in space? Yes. And I'd be excited to go back to the moon. And I can't understand for the life of me why we didn't go back from 1972 onwards. To me, I think we were put off. And there are real reasons that will come out in time long after I'm dead as to why we didn't go back to the moon.
Nice answer. Thank you, Gary. And before we wrap up, I'd just like to say because we've had a couple of guys giving us a shout out on their broadcasts, and I'd like to return the favour because I know we've got a few listeners off them from their channels. So I'd like to give a shout out for Hairy Cookie Monster. I've been listening to him for back over the years when I first started getting involved in all this. He's got his own channel, and if you look on YouTube for Hairy Cookie Munster, M-U-N-S-T-R, he's on at 9 p.m. on Mondays, and then there's Pete with Reality Chat, it's called, and he's on Wednesdays at 8 p.m. and they have some fascinating discussions. They're two very well-read guys. Anybody who's looking for anything to listen to at that time of those evenings, I'd thoroughly recommend it. There's something really weird going on with my ears at the minute, so I'm going to hand over to Jason to wrap up.
Okay, well, big thanks to you, Andy, and to you, Gary, as well. We'll definitely see you at the conference, myself and Andy. we'll be there. And there are still tickets available, aren't there? Just remember,
I think there's about 50 tickets left per day, but they don't hang around. Book them sooner than rather than later. Get your accommodation sorted.
UFO, the website?
UFOtruthmagazine.co.uk. That's all you need to put in.
Brilliant.
Well, it's been a radio show.
It's been an absolutely fascinating couple of hours. I've got to tell you, I've learned so much. Not least for all the people that are watching on Google, that if I hold my stump like this, it looks like I'm holding a very ugly baby.
Well, what I can say to you is I can't think I've ever seen that on a radio show before, so that's a first for me.
Brilliant. Anyway, listen, thank you very much to everybody. Thanks to you, Gary. Thanks to everybody for listening. We'll be back next week. It's raconteursnews.com. The website is back. Don't forget the forum as well. If you can find on the raconteursnews.com website, you can find a link to the forum. The forum's up there. Please join. Get involved in the... we've had a few more people join. Get involved. It's a place where we can all meet up and post different articles and opinions and stuff like that. So big thanks to you, Gary. Big thanks to Andy. Thanks to everyone in the chat room who's been participating. I understand I've not been able to watch it very much, but I understand it's been quite lively. But I've had a wife with a migraine over here, so I've sort of been back and forth. Anyway, we'll be back next week here on Raconteurs News, and we're going to leave you with this.
Oh, before you go, Jason, do you think you might need this?
Say that again, sorry.
So before you go, do you think you might need this?
Yeah, I probably will. Right, can I go now? Thanks, Gary. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Looking from the window above, it's like a story of love.
Are we off air now then, Andy?